Hey, hello. Good day, everybody. So topic for today is to check out how or learn how to do the client counterpart for user authentication and authorization, which we had a lesson last time. So now when we are going to be doing the client part, we of course still need the API there, and I'm going to be using the application in this repository, api-authentications-demos. So I will share this to your chat, this link to this GitHub repository. So the code in this repository will serve as the API in the demo where I'm going to be showing today. And this API authentication demos, this is an Express-based application, which uses the passport to do HTTP basic and JSON web token-based authentication. This will be our API. Then our client code is here. So if you want to see the outcome already, you can find it from there. That's the link is in the repository. So this demonstrates now the React application, which works together with this API. And for this application, there are two versions. Here in this main branch, there is a version where the React context is being used to share the authentication information across the components which are involved in the process or need the information. Then here, there is another branch called out state based. So this branch does not use the context. Instead, it uses normal React state to store the authentication information after login process, and then uses regular props to share that information. And I'm going to be demonstrating today to build this application from this out state based branch. So, the reason for that is that it is a little bit simpler than the context based. So, if you want to see how to use the context to share the authentication information, you can go to the main branch. But if you want to see how to use the basic state, so it's going to be in this branch. Okay, so that's it. So what I'm going to be doing is that I will build this application, this state-based application from scratch. So the first thing to do, go on and use the create React app, and then do the React auth as demo. So create the React project with the create React app. And oops, it takes a little bit to complete. So what we are now going to be building is that we will build a simple application which has sign up form, it has a login form, then it has a view which is available for everybody, also for users which are not logged in, and then it has this kind of protected view which is only available for users who have logged in, and in this view we load data from the API using JSON web token. I will show how this looks like in practice. So what is the end result here? This one. Is the client. I will start the API. And this is now running in port 5000. So when you are dealing with this, that you have both the API and the client application in its development environment running in the same machine, you need to be aware that which ports you are using. The Create React app by default starts in the port 3000. So your API cannot use the same port. Here I have configured the API to use port 5000. Both of them are running in the same machine, so the address is localhost, but the port is different. So now in my React application, which is running in the development server offered by Create React app, it is running in localhost port 3000, and it will connect to the API at localhost port 5000. I will show by using Postman that what does the API offer here. So let's send some requests. Let's send some requests there. And here is the, no, not here, but here is the API authentication demos. And there is a bunch of routes here in this project. There is the API key. Here is the HTTP basic authentication, which we did last time. And here we have a route which is called register basic. And this is now a post route, which expects data in the request body in this format. So it's a JSON object which has three properties, username, email, and password with some values. So this path will be used to register a new user to the system. Then we have a login path, which is used with the JSON web token. And this login path is using now the HTTP basic mechanism for getting the login information, meaning the username and password will be sent using the HTTP basic. So they will be transmitted in the header. So once we have a user, we will use this path with HTTP post. We will send a post request to this path with username and password in the header. And then as a response, we will get a token, JSON web token, which we can then use to make requests to a protected resource. And that protected resource is now here, this one. So this to-do's JWT with GET is protected with the JSON web token. And what this does is that it gets all the to-do elements. So this API is basically an API implementation of a simple to-do application. So there can be this multiple users, and each user can have multiple to-do items in the API, stored by the API. So this is the one what we will request in our client once we have performed the successful login operation. So let's see how does it work. How does it look like, the outcome, what we will be building. NPM run start to start the development server. And oops, this is now actually incorrect. What did I start? Router demo. Yeah, this is incorrect. It should be this one. Is it this one? I have so many React projects now in the drive, so yeah. Okay, so this is the one what we were looking for. Here, when I start the application, it immediately shows that I am logged in. So this is the common view, and the idea is that we show that we are logged in, and then based on this status, the view is different for a logged in and non-logged user. And now I'm logged in because I have the login information stored in local storage. So I'm going to erase the local storage information. So now we have the situation what what an empty application when it started for the first time. So the user is not logged in, and this is the homepage for the whole application. And now, based on the login status, if the user is not logged in, we show these links to these views to sign up or login. And if the user is logged in, then we show a link to go to a protected view. But this view, what we are now showing, this is now common for both and available for both logged in and not logged in users. So when I go here to the login, I can log in with an existing user. So there is an hard-coded user in the API called tester, and with the password, tester password. When I click here login, it indicates that the login is now successful, and now the user has logged in, and I am at the root path, as you can see from here. And now in the root path, the view has changed a little bit. There is no need to show login and sign up links anymore for a logged in user. So therefore now I have this link that go to protected view. So this protected view now represents an application what you would show once the user has logged in. So I go here, this is now the protected view. It is showing with this kind of red so that it is clear that this should only be available for users who have logged in. And we are using the router, so we are at path protected. Here is a demonstration that we are reading the payload from the JSON web token. So the API, when we do the login, it creates us a JSON web token. And to the payload of the JSON web token, it stores the ID of the user and email of the user. And here, this is now a demonstration that in the client, you can decode the payload of the JSON web token and then use it in some way. Here it is used only to print it for the user. Then we have one button here. So when I click on this button, the client, this React application, will send a request for the API for the protected route to get the so-called to-do items of this user, since the API is basically an API application for a to-do application. Kind of like Hello World number 2, what the to-do application is. So when I click here, it sent the request and immediately displays here the to-dos which are for this user. Then I can go back to the main view. I am still logged in. You notice that here the route changed. I can go back to the protected view. You notice that here the protected route is now used. Then if I want to log out, I can click here on the logout button. And now we are back in the home view, even though we try to access this protected. But when you log out, it automatically changes the view back to this default view, no matter which route is written here. So this kind of application, what we are going to be creating. So purely a technical demonstration of how to do the login, how to do the sign up, how to deal with a successful login, and how to load data from an API using a JSON web token, and also how to decode the JSON web token. So this is the objective here. If you have any questions, just ask at any time. There is no need to wait for those. So now I have created an empty or a new Create React app based project. And for this, what I'm going to be doing is that I will clear the default content here. This is not what we need at all. Do a authentication demo. I will clear the CSS. I don't need this CSS styling here. I will keep the CSS file. If I need any CSS styling, I will use that there. Okay, so now next step is to start to create a couple of components. And this was our goal. So what we will do is that I will create three different components now for us to use. First one is this home view. Then actually there will be four components. First is this home view. Second is the login view. So the form which is displayed when you click on the login. Third one is a form to do the sign up. And fourth is then the protected view. So I'm going to create these components now immediately. So first I will start from the home. Just an empty component here with the printout. Then I will create the login view. So this will be loginview.js. Getting these from templates, so with the shortcut RFC, I get the basic functional component. This is the login. Then I will create the sign up view. This is the sign up, and then I will do the protected. So the idea is that all these views will then be managed by the router. By the router component, and I will immediately go here to the protected view and set that this, there is a class name that this is now the protected. So I will use the red styling so that we can easily recognize when the protected view is visible. So I will put the background color to be this nice bright red. And then I have now these four components: home, login, sign up, and protected views. I will import all these components here. So import the home, import the login from login, it's a login view. Import then the sign up view from sign up view, import protected view from protected view. So now I have these four components here. And next step is to render all these components. So I will do it like this, that we have here in the beginning, we have some common header that this is now React authentication demo. And then what we'll do is that just render these components. Like so. So now we have something visible here. Let's start the development server. But before starting the development server, I will go and install the React router package. Now there was some installation command to give it. I don't remember what was it. So it is here, React router DOM 6. Basic installation. Was it not that there should be some history packet as well? Okay, maybe not. Install the React router. And then we can start the development server, see that what do we have there. Okay, so now we have the home. we have the login, sign up, and protected views all are rendering successfully. So that's great. Let's do it so that I'll put this one here. So these are side by side. Easier visualization. Okay, so first thing what I'm going to be doing is that I will set up the router to manage the display of these, and based on the route so that we can navigate between these views. So to get the router working, I will import the browser router. Browser router from the React router DOM. Then from the browser router, I will also need the routes and the route components. So let's wrap now these components, this home, login, sign up view by the router. So the idea is that this header one and the login status that we'll eventually have there, that this will be always visible and the router will manage content below it. So we have here the browser router. There. And then we need to define the routes. These will be the routes. And then we'll define route for each one of these. So we'll have path, and the default path will be for the element, and the element for this default path will be the home. Here. And then we have the login view. So this will be path login. And here we will have login view. Then we will have path sign up. And then we have sign up view. Then we'll have the protected. This is the protected view. Like so. So now we are at the home view. So now we can go on and build the home view to offer us links to go to the sign up and to go to the login views. So instead of printing this is home, all we can have this is the home. Okay, it can be there. And then what we'll do is that we'll have here link and to. It will go to sign up. Then it will say sign up. Then we can have a line break and we'll have another link. Login. Okay, like this. Now it's just that those components link, or that component link is not recognized. So we'll need to import it from the router. React router DOM. Okay, so now we have the sign up and login. We can go to the sign up. We can go to the login. All right. So let's start this sign up. We'll build this sign up first. So the idea is that we can create a new user to the system. The API authentication demos API, it has two built-in users already, but let's create here a form with what we can use to create a totally new user. So I will go to the sign up view. So this is the sign up. Like so. And now what I'm going to be doing is that I will create here a form element. Then this form has now these three fields. So our API was expecting username, email, and password to be given and submitted. So I will have a form which has three fields for those pieces of information. So here I will have, first I will have the username, line break, and then I will have an input field with type text. And now there are many ways in React how you can deal with forms, but what I'm going to be doing now is that I will deal with the form when there is a click on the submit button. I will not have these controlled input fields where we have a state tracking each one of these. That is not required here for any reason. So this is going to be the username, first field. Then there will be the email. I will use this name attribute for these input elements, because from these name attributes, I can then access the values of the fields when there has been the submit event. Like this. Then of course I need to have the button to trigger the submission of the form. So here we have the sign up button, and it looks like this. So we have three fields and then a button to the sign up. The idea is that I can write here the username, the email, and then the password. Click on the sign up, and then this application sends a request to the API with that information, and then responds that what is the situation, was there a successful sign up or not. I will also add a link. Oh, okay, well, we don't need a link there. Let's do it so that when there is a successful sign up, it will automatically navigate back to the home view where they log in and then be accessed. So it will not do automatic login, but after sign up, the user must manually do the login. Okay, so the form element we can do here with on submit React event, and then we can do here. Give here a function what to execute when there is an on submit. So I will define here a function that, okay, a function with this name should be called and executed when the submit button is clicked. So now I will define the function here, handle sign up submit, and it is an arrow function here, which gets an event as a parameter. So we can see out that what is the, if I go here to the console log and put here event, what kind of information I get from there. If I open the console. Okay, first. By default, form triggers a post event, and as you can see, it reloads this whole view. So that's not going to work. So for that reason, what I need to do is that I go here an event and prevent default. So when I call this one, it will prevent the default behavior of a browser. Now there is no longer the page refresh what the browser would do with a normal form submission event. Okay, I can get quite a lot of information from this form event that I'm printing out here. But if I would like to access the values of these three fields, there is this kind of notation, event.target.username. So this username now refers to the name what we have here in the form. There are three forms. three, four fields. Let's do the three printouts there. And now if I put here UWE, we should see, okay, yeah, I forgot to have that. We must print the actual value. This, okay, no, let me try. Not passwords, but password. Okay, now we get the QWE. Now we can get access to the written text in these form fields. So that is an important thing. Okay, so now what to do with this information? Well, we need to create an HTTP request and then send it to the API. And the API accepts, we can see here, that we have the register here, register basic. So it must be in this kind of format. We can try this out with the postman here. So if I go with the register basic, there it must be a post. It's now running in port 5000. Then I create the body, raw JSON, and then I'll copy here. We have a username foobar and then some password. So those are now the values what I would be sending for based on my form. Now I have the created there. The server will respond with created and the status code 201 created. So this is a sign that now the user has been successfully created and that it could be used to log in to the API to get a JSON web token for later use. So now in my code, I must recreate this process. Create an HTTP request, send it to this address with this kind of content, and then we should be good to go. And what I'm going to be doing is that I will use a library called Axios to send it, so therefore I will need to install it as well. Install Axios. And I will do the whole submission the whole sending of the HTTP request here in the signup view. I will not do it in any other component, but I will do it here because that's the whole idea of this signup. So there is no need to transmit the values of these form fields anywhere up to any higher component. So let's import the Axios library, Axios from Axios. And the Axios will give me an exception if there is a failure. So if the server doesn't respond, for example. So I will write here a try catch statement to catch the error, the exception what the Axios might send. So inside the try block, I will have the request sending and then the processing of the successful case. And then if there is some kind of exception sent by the Axios library, then I can catch it here and then deal with that error situation. So that is what I'm going to be doing here. And we are dealing with this try catch statement. And the Axios and the whole HTTP network request now, it is an asynchronous event. So I will send a network request and I might get the response fast or I might get a response sometime later. So there is no knowing that when does it give a response. So for that reason, the implementation will also be using the asynchronous concept in JavaScript, which means that the JavaScript execution will not stop, hold and wait for the response, because it might take a long time to get the response. If the application would wait for the response, it would mean that the application would basically hang until there is a response. So for that reason, the network request will be sent as an asynchronous operation, which means that this JavaScript application, this React application, will continue execution and it will stay responsive to the user, even if the network request might take several seconds to complete. of course, in our local host, if the server is running, it doesn't take several seconds, but still we are going to be doing it in this way. And in JavaScript, you have multiple ways of dealing with these asynchronous operations. Classically, there was this concept of callback being used. So you would give a function for the asynchronous operation to execute once it has completed. Then after that, there was introduced a concept called promise. So a promise is basically like in plain English, that it is a promise that something will be done later on, not just certainly, but when. So the promise is one way how to do it. From the implementation point of view, writing code, it looks quite a lot like dealing with callbacks. And then there is a newer way, something called async await, which works on top of the promises. So anytime when you have an operation which returns a promise, you can use the async await. And the async await gives by far the most simple code syntax, in my opinion. So it is quite nice to write. And the code syntax looks like it is a synchronous operation, like there would be waiting happening. But because you are using the async await syntax, it is actually an asynchronous operation. And how it works is that here I would send now the Axios post operation, or whatever it is, dot, dot, dot. Not having the details yet. So not, this would trigger the asynchronous operation. If we would be writing with promises, we would have here dot then and then some function written here. But now when we are using async await, we can simply put here that we want to store the result of this operation to this result variable. It might have a whatever name. And then I have here the word async, await. So this await is now a command that deal with the response given by this method call by stopping the execution basically here. And then when you get the response, then the execution continues from the next line. And to get this await working, the function inside which this await is used must be created by using the keyword async before the function. So here I have now the function declaration. So before the function, I'm using the async keyword so that I can use the await inside this function. Okay, so I will get the results here, and then here I can then do something with the result. But before going there, let's first formulate the actual request. So how the Axios post looks like. We can check out here from the documentation. Axios post, it looks like this, that we define the path, the address where to send. Then we can give here an object, which would be the body of the request for the post. Here you can see the then and catch syntax of dealing with the promises. We are now using await, async await, so we don't need to use this. But post method call is the same. So we need to put here as the first parameter, we need to put the address where we are sending it. Localhost port 5000. Then the second parameter would now be the content for the body. And now our body, it was looking like what the API specified, like this. There must be a username, and well, I will read the username from there. Then I will have the email, and it will come from there. And then I will have the password, and it will come from there. I'm going to be creating here an object with these properties and with these values. And that object is sent to the server at this address. Now to avoid hard coding these addresses. For example, in our exercise, when you are developing in your own computer, you might have a local host, maybe port is 5000. But then when you deploy to production server, let's say you deploy to Azure, maybe you deploy to Heroku, wherever, then in the client application, you would need to update all these addresses. And if you have these addresses hard-coded into multiple components, it is a very error-prone situation and quite bothersome to do. So for that reason, I will create here a file called constants.json. And the idea with this file is that it could hold all our constants for this application, whatever those might be. And this is a simple JSON file. So I will create here a property. Let's call it API address. And the API address will be now localhost port 5000. Now the idea is that if I need to change the address, I change it here. And in all my code, I use this API address from this constant JSON. You could use this, for example, from the environment as well. That's one possibility. Let's deal with this with the constant approach. So now I'm going to import this constants from constants.json. And then I can use my constant here. So I can replace this one, constants.json. And it automatically reads it, that API address. Okay, but there is actually the register basic path. So now I can append this API address. Okay. All right, let's see what we have for the result then. Console log result. And then if we have the error, let's print out it here, console.error, error. So we can see what is happening there. Okay, so here we are. We are at sign up. Let's open the console here. We have username Q, email W, password E. Sign up. Now we got this here as a response. This is now the contents of this result object. So you can see we have status 201, status text created. And it seems that the whole operation passed quite fine. Okay, so now we have created the user and it was a successful operation. So now we could automatically navigate here so that the user could go the login view. Well, we could navigate to the login view directly, for example, as well. And navigate in a dynamic fashion so that you have some code where you want to execute the navigation. There is a hook, a React hook available in the React router DOM. It's called use navigate from React router DOM. And then here, you can simply call you get access to the navigate method. Navigate, use navigate like this. Now we can use this navigate method here. So navigate, and then where we want to navigate to. So we can put here that we navigate to login. Then it's possible to, even here when we have the navigate command, so the React router is maintaining a navigation history. That is, the history is built up as a stack data structure. So you can go back in the navigation history quite easily. So now when you call this navigate and you give a path, you can decide as a programmer or as a developer that, do you want to keep the navigation history or not? So in this case, when we have done a sign up successfully, it doesn't make much sense to keep the navigation history so that the user could click on the back button go back to the sign up and then maybe accidentally submit the same information again. So we can put here a configuration object with value replace true. It means that now replace the navigation history. Okay, let's see. Sign up. A, B, C. And it navigates automatically. Now, we could polish this sign up so that when we click on the sign up, it would maybe indicate that what is happening here. What is happening here on the, so that it would indicate for the user that what is happening, because the sign up process, it might take, let's say, a second or two, depending on how fast the server responds. Now it was instantaneous because we have this on the same machine. So what we could do is that we could hide this button, this sign up button, so that when the user clicks it, the button is hidden to avoid that there is a second sign up event with the same information. So we could do it like that. And then we could replace it with some text saying that now we are, for example, processing. And then when we get the result, we could indicate that, yeah, login successful, or we could say that we have an error and then do whatever we want to do. So if we do that, we are basically talking about conditional rendering here again. And I will do this with the switch case statement. So what I'm going to be doing is that I will create a simple state to this sign up view. And based on the state, on the login, or I mean the sign up process state, I will decide what to show in the UI. So that's what I'm going to be using a state for. And I will do the state with the use state hook. So let's declare the state variable. So sign up process state, for example, then set sign up process state will be the method what can be used to modify it. And now we can decide that, okay, how do we want to express the state? I will simply express it as strings. So as a default state, there is going to be the idle state. Okay, let's then create the switch case statement to deal with the different states. So first, what we will do is that I will create here a variable where I will hold this UI representation depending on whatever is then the state. So sign up UI controls, for example, let's set it to be null by default. And then we have the switch case statement. And I'm going to use the switch case statement for this conditional rendering because we have multiple states. We have this idle state where we are now. Then we have the state when the sign up has been clicked, so we are processing. And then we have the state where the login was successful or there was some problem. So we have at least four states in our mind. So I'll use the switch case here. So switch for the sign up process state like this. And then for the case that we are idle, let's set the sign up UI controls to show our button. And let's render the sign up UI controls here. So now we have modified the code a little bit. There is no visible change here yet. Then, like we discussed, that there will be case, let's say, processing. In this case, the sign up UI controls will not be a button, but maybe maybe a text with style. What would be the style here? Well, maybe there is no need for a style. It says now processing. We have the successful case. Okay, let's say complete or success. Sign up UI controls will be now a span of, and it has some styling, let's say color green. Sign up for success. And then we can have a sign up failure, for example. And this is now with the color red, and then this, let's say, error. Okay, so we have now these states. We could have there a default as well, but I'll leave it now out. These four states. So it would mean that when we click on the button, the sign up button, we would go to this processing state. So here, before we send the request, so then we would set sign up process state value would be processing. And if we have an error, set sign up process state, we would have sign up failure. And then if we are successful, we have the sign up success. Okay, let's try this. So I will shut down the API so that we can test these states. So if I have here A, B, and C, it's now saying processing, and then there is some kind of timeout. Now it says error. Here that. A, B, C, processing in the blue, and then we get an error text. Error text with the red. Okay, that's when we don't have a server running. Now we have a server running. Let's try to do it again. So A, B, and C. Okay, now we have a sign up success. It was showing quickly the processing, and then it changed state to the sign up success. Now we would like to navigate after this to the login view. So, but let's have there a small delay. So we can have here a small timeout. Small timeout. Let's say a timeout of 1.5 seconds. And when the timeout has been completed, then we do the navigation. Like so. Now we can try it. So if we have these sign up success and then 1.5 seconds, it goes to the login view. Okay, so now the sign up is completed. Now we should show the login form, and it is pretty much the same like what we have here. So again, it's going to be a form. Then there's going to be these. Why did it autocomplete? Then there's going to be these input fields where there is this username, and this username can be an input field as well. I mean, sorry, an email as well. It doesn't matter what you are putting there, and we'll have the password. Like so, and then we have the button. Oops, did I use the submit? Okay. Okay, so now we have here the button visible, and same thing here with the on submit. Login submit, so a function will be declared here. So const handle login submit. The structure of this login view and signup view is going to be pretty much the same. They'll have extremely similar structures. Even this is going to be the same as well if we do the information presentation in the same way what we did for the sign up. So probably you could combine these into some kind of modular component if you'd like to do really reusable code. But I'll be writing this basically over again. So here on the login submit, we'll have the try catch. We need to import the Axios. We have the constants API address, and then where we will be sending it, the register login is here, login for JSON web token. So login for JWT, and it is a post method. And now we must do the basic authentication. So we don't have anything in the body. Here we can see in the Axios documentation that request config. We can pass a third parameter for the Axios requests. It's called the request config, and here is the documentation for that. And here is one useful property called auth, which indicates that HTTP basic auth should be used. So we can give the username and password like this and not worry about doing the base64 encoding and setting the headers with authorization field and so on. So we can use this one here quite conveniently. But now normally the post method, the second parameter is the request body. So we don't have any request body now. That is here in the login view, yeah, it's this one. So the second parameter will now be null. We don't send any request body, even though we have a post request. The third parameter will be now the request config object. And there I will have the auth property used. It is now an object as well. And it has username. Then it has the password. Now these values will come from the event. Since we have a username and password, so it will be event target username value. And here, event target password value. And we have an async await. We need to remember here to have the async, like so. Let's comment these out or delete here. A constant is not defined. Okay, so now we have our login So I'm going to be using now the hard-coded tester and tester password. So these were hard-coded to the API implementation, to this one. They are defined elsewhere, not in this file, but elsewhere. So I will use this one because we need to restart probably the API sometime. Okay, login. Error request aborted. What was the problem? Do we have the API ongoing? Yes. So what's happening here? Okay, so now it's sending it. It is sending it in the URL. Wow, why does it do it? Ah, yes, it does it because I have forgotten to override the default form submission. Yeah, form by default, it sends the form fields in this kind of fashion. As you can see, they are encoded in the URL. We don't want to do that. So tester password. Let's see. Now we got here a status 200 response. Here we have our token. Okay, so it was a successful login. So we sent HTTP requested post method to this path with HTTP basic authorization. And in our result, what we are printing out here, we have the token token already ready to go. So let or here const received JWT is then in the result, it is then in the data.token. So here you can see that we are printing this. So we have the data property and then it is an object which has one property called token. So result data token. We have now access to the JSON web token what the API gave us. So this is already pretty cool. So now we could navigate back into our application, into the application. And the idea would be though that we would have the login information now saved and the application state would reflect that now we are logged in. If you want to use the navigate here, we need to again import the use navigate hook. We need to get the navigate method. And then we can here navigate to root, and then again I will replace the entire navigation history. Okay, so tester password, click login, and now we should be logged in. So the idea would be that show here that user login status is logged in or not logged in. So the idea would be that we could show it here. But before going there and starting to think that how to store the navigation, I mean the login information, let's have a break of 15 minutes. Or does somebody have any questions at this moment? So far what we have done is that we have created two components or implemented the signup view, login view, and we have sent network requests from those and done some router navigation. So this is not yet that much of a problem if you realize that in any case you need to send those network requests. But any questions at this moment before we have a break? Okay, well, you can ask also after the break or during the next session as well. So a 15-minute break, so we continue at 14:20. Okay, let's continue. So now we have in our app root, we have declared the browser router. We have created the signup component and the route for it. We have created the login component and the route for it. Now, what we are going to be doing is that let's first implement this status, whether or not the user is logged in. And this is going to be in the home component. So the idea is that this home component is visible both for the non-logged in and logged in users. So again, what we have here is that basically we have conditional rendering. So how to do this conditional rendering? Again, you need to use these curly brackets. And then we now need to have some variable which we are checking. And let's do so that the state of the application, meaning that the state of this login, will be stored here in this app. And it will be passed to this home component via props. So therefore, let's do it so that we have here props user logged in. And if this is true, then we will render this part here. And so, if not, then we'll render this part here. Okay, so now it's saying that user status not logged in. And that is the case because this home component is not receiving any props from here. So the prop user logged in is not defined. Let's define it here. If we put here true, now you can see that it changes. If you change this to false, it changes. Okay, so now we need to declare the state variable here. So to declare the state variable here in this app, we need to import the use state from React. And this React. Now we can declare here that const is user logged in. And set is user logged in. And by default, we have the value to be false. Now, if we have here true, it changes because this state is not yet passed to our home component as a prop. So now it changes. And now it changes again to not logged in. Now, what we would like to have besides this text changing, we would like to have these also changing, these sign up and login. So we can do those so that we do conditional rendering here as well. But if we have that the user is logged in, if we have this situation, what should we display here? And the answer is that we should display our protected view component, which is now available here in the protected. So this is the one what we would like to get access to from this home view if we are logged in. So we can do it here again by doing conditional rendering on these links. So we can do it so that here props user logged in. If true, then what we'll show, we'll show not these, but the protected. And if the user is not logged in, then we will show these. JSX fragment. Okay. This JSX fragment means that we cannot return two elements at the same level. It must always be a single element which can have multiple children. And if you don't, you could put here, for example, div. But if you don't want to have a div, you just want to return those links without any actual element being realized. You can use this kind of fragment syntax. This satisfied this JSX rule that there must always be a single element which is returned, but this fragment doesn't translate into an actual HTML element of any kind. Okay, so now this is the one what we would see when the user is logged in. When the user is not logged in, we would see this. And then if we have this, that the user is not logged in, we of course would like to also to have the capability of preventing the user from writing this route path to the protected route, so that this would not be available at all. And you can achieve that as well with the conditional rendering. So what we would like to have, so that if the user is logged in, we could not go again to login even by writing. Now we don't have any links here, but we can always write here, login and go back to login. So we would like to avoid that. And we would like to avoid also for the user to be able to write when he is not logged in, write the path of some protected route, which would only be visible when the user is logged in. So we have those requirements. So what we can do is that we can use conditional rendering for these routes. And I'm going to do it like this, that we have here, not a const, but let auth routes. This is the variable what I've decided to use for here. And the idea is that this is the default case, that when we are not logged in, then we are going to be showing these two. Then we have the JSX fragment here. So this is the default case, but if is user logged in equals true, then auth routes equals to this protected. So this protected route only becomes available when the user is logged in. And then what we can do here is that render the auth routes. So now if I change here that the state is, okay, we have here now the false state. All right. Now if I try to write here protected, we cannot get any access. Instead we get empty because the router doesn't recognize this route at all. It is not defined to our current router. If we have the user is logged in, we are saved. Now if we write protected, now we can get access to this. But when we are here and user is logged in, we cannot access the login. We get again to an unrecognized state. So we can avoid this unrecognized state by here on the bottom of the route hierarchy. We can declare here a path which matches everything. So no matter what you write, you will always be taken to home. This star is this wild card. So if I write here, blah, 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 I always get to home, never matter. And if I put here protected, I get to the protected. If I put here login, now I get back to the home view because the home will be matched by this star. So this is the one trick what you can use to restrict access between logged in and not logged in users. Okay, but then how do we how do we go from our, so that we would actually be changing this state based on the login information. So we were dealing with the login here in the login view. And when we have a successful login, we simply navigate here. Simply navigate to the root path, but we don't modify the state in any way. So we would need to do something for that. So what we want to do is that for this login view, we want to provide a function to execute when there is a successful login. And we will do it via the props. So the idea is that we give a prop with the name login. And then here, when we have actually done the successful login with the server, then from our props, we can call this login method. So we go here that props login. And now, because we are, when we do the login, we get the JSON web token. So of course we need to store it somewhere, and we're going to be storing it JSON web token for later use now in the state of the app. And we'll deliver the JSON web token, which is now here, via this login method call. So this received JSON web token will be passed with the login method call. And then we'll do the navigation back to root. So now, here now we do the declare the function that here we have this new JSON web token, which we receive. And then we'll write here a function implementation. And what we will do is that we'll set this user login to true. We could also store the JSON web token. So we can declare another variable for that. User JWT set user JWT use state, and we begin from null. So now we could store it also, that set user JWT to the new JWT, what we get from the event. So here we declare the function, what is being called from here in the login view here. And here in the login view, when we call the login, we give the received JSON web token. And it gets here in this function as a parameter new JWT, and we store it here. Okay, so now we have a Boolean variable, which decides if the user is logged in or not. And then we have the user JSON web token. So now you might realize that, okay, if we are storing the JSON web token, when the user is logged in, and when the user is not logged in, we have a null in the JSON web token. So you realize that maybe we don't need this user logged in at all. It's enough if we store this user JSON web token and check that out. So here we have this is user logged in. We're going to change it so that user JWT equals something else than null. Then we can show this. And then here, user logged in, we could keep this around, but I'm going to simply replace this with the JSON web token. Here, for example, have a condition. Condition to do it. Well, we can do it. It's my mind. So user JSON web token. And if this is something else than null, and here as well, user web token. So now we are passing true or false there inside. Okay, somewhere else 14, this one, this is not needed anymore. And now we don't need to have the curly brackets here at all. We simply can have here set user JSON web token, get out. So it will look a little bit more simpler. Like so. Here we don't need to have those at all. Okay, so we are going to be storing the JSON Web Token here, and then based on if we have the JSON Web Token stored, we'll render the protected routes here, or we'll render the login and signup routes if we don't have the JSON Web Token. And for the home view, we pass a true or a Boolean value, whether or not we have the user JSON Web Token stored or not. Okay. So we are almost there. So if we now go here that we store tester password, I click here on the login. This is the home, user is now logged in. Now we can access the protected view, and here we are. We are going to next be implementing this protected view, that how in this view we could then decode the JSON Web Token if we would need to, and how we could use the JSON Web Token to load some protected content from the API. So implementing this protected view is the next phase, since currently it only looks like this. So protected view, H2, and then let's put here below the decode JSON token data. Yeah. And decode the JSON web token. We are going to be using the same library that we used to create it. So here in this API implementation, we are using this JSON web token library. Let's see where it is required. Here. So on the server side, we are using this JSON web token library, and we're going to be using that same library on the client side as well. It has the capability of decoding a token as well as to sign it. While it installs, we can check out. Here is the usage. Here is about how to sign. Then we have here is how to verify, if you need to verify a token. And then here is the decode. And by default, it decodes the payload. So you remember the token is made up of the header, payload, and signature. So this decodes and returns the payload. We can see how it works. So, and to decode the JSON Web Token, we would of course need to get it here somehow. And we do it by the mechanism of props with the protected view. So now in here in the app, where we have the protected view here, we need to deliver the JSON Web Token there. For the JSON Web Token, let's put the value user JWT. So now through this prop JWT in the protected view, we can get access to the JSON Web Token. Let's see, const decoded token equals import JWT from JSON Web Token. So JWT decode, it was here decode, then there is an optional options. We don't need any options. So we go simply to props JWT. So now let's see what we have here in the decoded token if we log it to the console. Console will get, we need to do the login first, then go to protected view. And here we got now the printout of the token. So the token is an object. It has the EXP and IAT properties. So the EXP is now the expired, a Unix-based timestamp, issued at Unix-based timestamp. And then we have the payload, user with the email and ID. here we can read then the user ID is token.user.id. Then user email, decoded token user.email, correct. And there we have, now we have, we are reading the values, the payload from the token. So now it is up to you as a developer to decide that what kind of payload you want to store in your token. This API implementation, when it signs the token, or when it creates the token, it stores these two values and they are here. So here we have this login. So here we are creating this user payload. It's just the ID and email. We are creating the payload user with these kind of object. And then we have an option here which expires in 1 day. So it results in the payload which has an object of the issued at timestamp, expires timestamp, and then this property user, which is then an object of this body, and it has those two fields, email and so on. And that's the reason why we can then use them here in our client. Okay, one remaining part is that we would like to now read user-specific data from a protected route. And for that, I'm going to be accessing this one. So we can see from the postman that if I execute, if I go, what was the path now? Yeah, login for JWT. And I go to authorization. I have here tester. Then I have tester password. I don't have any body. I send this. I get the token. And I can send a new request for 5,000 and now get this to-do's JWT, to-do's JWT with authorization, bearer, and the token here. And as a response, I get the to-dos of this user, and this user has only a single to-do. So there is no need to have here the user ID, like one, you can have it, but since you can read the user ID directly from the token, from the payload in the server as well, you can have a route like this as well in your code. So our server has a single element for the user to do, and it has been defined, hard-coded in the same way as our user has been hard-coded. So this project has a couple of these kind of services, so external files, where first file is this users, where we have this tester with tester password. Then we have a secondary module which stores these to-do elements. And the to-do elements are for each user. So hard-coded to-do is let's see where it is. Where have I put it? Was it here? Okay, it might be so that it's only in my own machine. Not yet in a commit. So this is now the code that I have in my machine. Yeah, okay, I have a modification here which is not yet in the GitHub. So here is the single to-do for this tester user, which has the ID of one. was not available in the GitHub yet. I will make it there after this lesson. Okay, so yeah, we were here. And our code is here. So now the like so that we have here a button and click to load user to-dos with JWT. We have this kind of button here, and when we click it, then it should send the request. Send the request to server. And again, we are going to be using the Axios to send it. So import Axios from Axios. And we'll again need to import also the constants. Constants.json. And with the button, when there is a click on click, so load data with JWT. So then we'll declare here const load data with JWT. It is now a function. So it is an async function. I already know it. I will have the try catch block here. So I can execute the access request, and then I will have the results and await Axios get, and it was the path was now to do JWT or what was it? So this one, yeah. So constants.api address plus the to-dos JWT. It's a get request. I get the results here. Let's print out the results. And let's print out yeah, as well. Okay, let's see. Syntax error 401. Yeah, so now it's saying that I don't have access there because I'm not transmitting my JSON web token as a bearer token. So to do that, I need to set a couple of headers here. And again, I can use the Axios request configuration object, which for this get method is now the second parameter. I already know it. So here I have now the configuration object, and I already know that if I can set the headers like so, headers like this. And now I can define here the headers what I want to send with my request. Now I can set the bearer token here. Suggests it here. So props JWT. So now this is the same thing what I did with the postman. And I selected here in this nice UI. This UI helps me to fill this authorization field with the value bearer space and then the token value. Now here in the code, I'm constructing the same field manually. And here it is. Let's try for round two. Okay, it worked. Now I have here the data. Here, now I have a single to-do element. Now I can use it here in my code. So I will, in this protected view, I will declare a state variable. I will store the to-dos what I load from the server. this. State, and by default it is an empty array. So then when I get the successful results, which was here, then I can go on and set user to-dos and results.data. That is directly an array, so I can go on and set it there. Now I can use it then here in my UI declaration. So I can go, for example, let's create a table. Table here, and so, and then I will go and map the user to-dos array. So user to-dos map. And then from here, what will happen is that I will have a single row with a couple of TDs, and here I have user dot, not the user, but the to-do. What kind of data I have there? I have description, the description, and I have the due date. Let's make this a bit better looking. I have the okay, there is even a bug statue. What a typo. Well, let's replicate it here. State you. Okay, so now I have a table which could show the results. When I click here, now I have the data visible here. And this data was now loaded with the JSON web token. Then to this view, I would like, of course, to have a possibility of going back to the home view. So that's with the link to. Go back to the root. Back to home. Link is not defined. I need to import it. Link from React Router DOM. And now I can click there. I can go to protected view. I can load data. Data is not persisting, as you can see, because it is stored in this component only. If you want to have persisting data, then you need to do something else. Then I could have here a logout functionality. Let's do it with a normal button. So when this button is clicked, then there is a logout event. So on click, and now this logout functionality is not really responsibility of this protected view. So I will implement it here in the application root, and then instead just call here a function which is delivered here via props. So props logout will be called or executed when there is an on click. So now I need to implement that one here to protect the route so that it is delivered. So there is the logout. And then when this logout is clicked, what happens is that I declare here a function. And what happens is that this set user JWT is used to set it to null. So we erase our JSON web token when the logout is called. Now if I click here, immediately, even though I was still in the protected route from the URL, as you can see, the router, when there is no longer the JSON web token stored, the router changes my view back to home. So it is immediately a logout event. Like, then I can log in back here. Now I'm logged in. I can go to protected view. I can go to home. I can go to protected view. I click logout, which erases the JSON web token. And notice here, now this URL, there is no navigate command at all. Instead, the protected view does not exist anymore for the router, because the JSON web token is deleted, and we were using here the conditional rendering. So that's it. There is one more thing what this application needs, and that is what happens here, that if I do the login, now I'm logged in, but if I reload this application, it is lost, because the JSON web token is only stored in the application state. So every time when I reload, the application is reload and the state is reset. So to have a persisting JSON web token so that you can log in once and then it stays there. So you need to use a browser storage. There is a session storage and local storage. Session storage is a place to store data what should be around as long as the browser is open. When the browser is closed, the session storage data is deleted. Local storage is something where you can store data and it persists over browser sessions. So you can close your computer today, come back tomorrow, and the data is still there in the local storage. So that's the one what we will be using to store our JSON web token, so that it is then persisting in our application. Okay, so let's do the part where we store the JSON web token local storage. And we'll do it here because this is the part, this is the function what we implemented deal with the successful login event. It receives the JSON web token and it sets to the application state. So here we'll make a second line of code show or to do with the local storage. So we can access the local storage from window. This local storage is now offered by the browser and it is in the global window object, local storage. And local storage has a couple of methods. It has set item and get item. Local storage works by key value principle so that all the data, all values are stored by keys. And these keys are now strings. And they are, the local storage is also per application domain. So you cannot load data of another application from another URL from the local storage. So all the keys what you use, they are your application keys only. You cannot access the key and data of another application. So I, for example, use here app auth data, or you could use whatever application JWT, user JWT or something. This will be the key, and this will be now the value. And in the browser, if you use the debugger mode open like you always should have, here in the I have Firefox, I have this storage view. And here I have a local storage. I have already something stored there from earlier applications in the local host. So now if I reload, you can see that the local storage is empty. There is no data. When I go here to login, I log in with the tester password, login, and now this was just written to local storage. My application is not yet using this data in any way, it just writes it there. If I reload, the application is reset and the user is not logged in, but here in the local storage, you can see that the JSON web token is still stored. So now to get access to this one and to persist the login over browser sessions, all what I need to do is that when this application starts, I check from local storage that do I have a token there? If yes, then use that one. And it is like this. I declare here a variable, window local storage, get item. And now I try to get an item with the key what I have used, app auth data. Then whatever this returns, if this key doesn't exist, it returns null. If it exists, it returns the data of this key. Here the value is not the token. So I use this as the initial value of my user JSON web token state variable. So now when I made this modification, when I load this browser again, this code is executed and I should be logged in. Or okay, you can see now I reload and I'm logged in. If I delete this token from the storage and reload, I am not logged in. I can go on and log in. I am logged in. The token is stored in the storage. I can reload. I'm logged in. I can go to protected view. I can load my data from there. I can go back and so on. So now if I click log out, it says here I'm not logged in. But if I reload, I'm still logged in. So this log out, what it should do, that it should delete now from the local storage. That's how you delete or log out permanently. So here we have the logout implementation where we set the user JWT null. So in addition to this, we should also delete the key. Delete the key from the local storage. And now I don't actually remember. Is there a command to delete the key or should I set the key to null? Let's see. Storage. Where do I have methods? Storage object, get item, remove item. Okay, clear. Okay, I can use this or I can use the remove item. So window local storage remove item and then with the item key what I want to remove app auth data. And then it should be done. Let's see. I am here at the protected view. I am still logged in. I click log out. It should delete now the local storage. Let's see. Yes, and it's gone. I am not logged in. If I reload, I am not logged in. So that's it. So for the React, how to deal with the user authentication is that you must know what your API expects from you and in what kind of format and how do you pass the authentication data. Here we used the HTTP basic for the login. So my login operation needed to match that one. It was here. The Axios offers direct support for the HTTP basic. Then when I am logged in and I want to load some data from the API, I need to use or deliver the token in the manner what the API expects. And in my case, the API expects it to be as a bearer token. So I set the token to the header like so. And then I can deal with it. And for then when you do with the application UI, depending on the logged in state, then you can store the information into normal React state, like we did here. And then if you have some child components which need the state information, you need to pass it via props, like we did here, that for the protected view, which requires the JSON web token, we passed it here with the props. So That's it. If you have then multiple child components which need the JSON Web Token, you need to pass it, the token, to all of them via the props mechanism. And when you want to have persisting login across browser sessions, then you can use local storage to store your token and then read it from there when the application starts. So that's it. And yeah, and as a last but not least, for the router, you can use conditional rendering to change the router configuration on the fly. So that's one thing to consider. In the React router documentation, in their tutorial here in the authentication, they have another kind of example of this. Oops. They have another kind of example of this. They are using pretty much the same logic, but in different syntax. So here they have this kind of syntax that they have the path to the protected elements or protected components. Then they have created this kind of require auth component, which wraps this protected page component. And this require auth now does this, basically this if else check. That this require auth works so that it checks that if the user is logged in, then great, then we render this. If the user is not logged in, then this require auth will throw the user back to the root element or root route. And we can see it here, the require auth is implemented here. It's a simple component. And here is the if statement. It checks that if the user has authentication information, or actually has not, if the user does not have the authentication information, then there is a navigate to command that we go back to the login. If the user has the authentication information, in our case, if the user would have the token, then the children of this require auth would be rendered, and means that then this would be rendered. So this is a different example of how different syntax logic, but same idea logic, that it is a basically if else statement. Here I have it here as a traditional conditional rendering where I modify the route structure on the fly based on the auth information, whereas they have fixed routing structure, but they check before each route that is it allowed or not. And if you read this React router example, then here they are using the context. So you might remember context is a mechanism in React which allows you to pass information without props. So dealing with this authentication information is a good use case for this context, but it is in no way required that you must use context for this. You can use just as well the normal state logic. But this, so if you go here to this example from the React router, here authentication, it is using the context example. And in this implementation, this React auth demo, this GitHub repository, it has both of these logics implemented. So this one, what I did just here, is available in this repository in the auth state-based branch. And in the main branch, there is a different version of this same application, but it uses the context to store the JSON Web Token. So if you're interested in how to use the context, you can check it out from there. But either way, it works just fine. Okay, any questions?
Mulla olisi yksi pikkuinen kysyri.
Joo.
Joo, näytäkö sitä rajapintaa siltä basic authenticationin kohdalta?
Ehkä tätä loginia.
Joo, basic, eli ylempää. Tänään yriteltiin vähän rakennella näitä, niin tuossa on tuo rekisteri basic. Onko se vielä pikkusen ylempää? Tässä. Tuo users Jursessa moduulissa on tämä getUserByName-metodi, joka ottaa tuon usernamein tuossa parametrina tuosta funktionista, mutta missä se välitetään funktionille tai tuolle funktiolle tuo username?
Tätä.
Niin, ja passwordia ja nämä. Me yritettiin tuota testailla ja määritellä niitä ja näin poispäin, mutta ei ole oikein sujunut.
Joo, eli tässähän nyt idea on se, että tässä käytetään tätä passport-kirjastoa.
No.
Ja tämän passportti on nyt sitten konfiguroitu tämä HTTP Basic-käyttö. Ja tämä toimii sillä tavalla, että kun tämä passportti on nyt aktiivisena, niin se passportti itsessään, jos meillä on tässä nyt tämmöinen reitti, missä on tämä HTTP Basic-suojaus, niin tässä on tämä middleware aktiivisena, niin se tarkoittaa sitä, että tämä passport-kirjasto katsoo pyynnön, joka tulee tähän osoitteeseen. Se katsoo, että onko siellä pyynnön headereissa nyt se oikea asetus, joka on oman näköinen, eli löytyykö sieltä pyynnön headerista authorization-kenttä, ja onko siellä tämmöinen arvo. Jos on, niin tuo passportti ottaa tämän merkkijonon tästä, mikä on siis Base64 enkoodatussa muodossa, se käyttäjätunnus 2.salasana. Se dekoodaa tämän ja irrottaa sieltä sen käyttäjätunnuksen salasanan, ja se tarjoaa ne tänne valmiina tähän funktiolle. Tämä passportti kutsuu tätä funktiota. Te ette itse voi tätä funktiota kutsua, vaan tämä passporttikirjasto, kun se on tällä tavalla Expressin middlewarena käytetty, niin se middleware aktivoituu ennen tätä reittikäsittelijää, kun tälle reitille tulee, tai tähän polkuun tulee pyyntö. Ja silloin tämä funktio, mikä on nyt sitten tämä itse kirjoitettu käsittelijäfunktio tämän basic-strategian käsittelyyn, niin se saa silloin valmiina sen käyttäjänimen ja salasanan. Ja sitten niitä voidaan käyttää, jotta voidaan hakea sieltä omasta käyttäjätallennuspaikasta, mikä se sitten onkaan, niin sieltä voidaan hakea sitten se käyttäjä ja tarkistaa, että mätsääkö se salasana. Okay. Ja tallennettu salasana. Niin se on semmoinen logiikka.
Okei. Okay. Joo, mä voisin laittaa sulle screenshottia huomispäivällä, kun me ollaan lopeteltu nyt tältä päivältä työt, niin sitten meidän ongelmasta niin voitaisiin vähän purua tosiaan tarkemmin.
Joo.
Me käytetään tosiaan nyt jo tietokantaa.
Joo, silloin teidän täytyy tietokannasta hakea. Tämän sijasta niin teidän täytyy tietokannasta hakea se käyttäjätieto ja sitten tarkistaa, että no, onko siellä semmoinen käyttäjä, jolla tämä username oli, ja sitten onko siellä käyttäjällä se salasana sitten oikein.
Joo. Joo, mutta kiitoksia kuitenkin tuosta, selvitti tuota logiikkaa jonkun verran.
Joo. Onko muita kysymyksiä? Any other questions?
Mitenkä sitten, kun meillä on manageri ja useri erikseen, ja niillä on tavallaan eri toimivaltuudet mennä eri sivuille, niin
joo.
Se sitten vaan, että missä se laitetaan tavallaan se tsekki siihen?
No, sitten se meni sillä tavalla, että kun teillä on tehty nyt se käyttäjä on kirjautunut sisään, oli se sitten manageri tai semmoinen tavallinen kuluttajakäyttäytyjä, niin miten mä sen tekisin, niin mä tähän payloadiin laittaisin uuden kentän, jossa kerrotaan sitten, että tämä nyt on manageri tai sitten tämä on tavallinen käyttäjä.
Joo,
se sitä, sitä voi tarkistaa sitten noissa reiteissä. Tai sitten sä voit tehdä sillä tavalla, että silloin kun sitä tässä tehdään tätä reitin autentikointia, niin te voitte tehdä toisen tarkistuksen tänne, missä sitten siitä payloadista, kun teillä on täällä nyt tieto, että okei, tämä nyt oli käyttäjä ID, se ja se, niin te voitte tarkistaa sitten sen jälkeen, kun tämä tokeni on tarkistettu, niin te voitte tarkistaa sitten, että no niin, nyt meillä on käyttäjä ID:llä 57. Onko käyttäjä 57 manageri? Ja jos tähän tarvitaan manageri oikeustaso, niin silloinhan tämä käyttäjä saa vastauksen. Jos se käyttäjä ei ole manageri, niin sitten hylätään se vastaan pyyntö.
Joo, meillä on siis nimenomaan on semmoinen is-manager tavallaan kenttä siellä payloadissa, että se on true tai false.
Joo, kyllä.
Kumpi se on.
Joo, se miten mä sen tekisin, niin mä kirjoittaisin omaan tämmöisen middlewaren, jossa se tehdään se tarkistus, että check if manager, ja se sitten lisättäisiin vaan tuohon toiseksi middlewareksi ennen tätä reittikäsittelijää niihin manageri-oikeuksia vaativiin reitteihin. Mutta sen voi aivan kirjoittaa tähän reittikäsittelijäkin sitten.
No miten se tavallaan Reactin puolella?
Reactin puolella siinä ei sitten ole mitään, ei ole niin kuin kantaa siihen, että miten se lähetetään. Reactin puolella sitten se liittyy oikeastaan siihen, että miten te olette rakentaneet sen sovelluksen, eli nyt kun teillä on tämmöinen sovellus, missä on niin sanottu tavallinen käyttäjä, sitten on ylläpitäjä, ja on tämmöinen ruoantilaussovellus, niin se, miten tämä todennäköisesti oikeasti tehtäisiin, tai miten minä sen tekisin oikeasti, niin siellä kuluttajasovelluksessa käyttöliittymässä, jos mennään vaikkapa volt.com, niin täällä ei ole sillä managerille keinoa kirjata sisään. Tämä login tarkoittaa ainoastaan kuluttajakäyttäjiä. Sen sijaan ravintolamanageri voisi olla joku sitten restaurant manager tai admin.volt.com toisessa osoitteessa, jossa sitten käynnistys erillinen sovellus, erillinen React-sovellus, joka on pelkästään sitä ylläpitäjää varten. Eli kun nyt tämmöisessä sovelluksessa todennäköisesti tilanne on se, että teillä olisi potentiaalisesti miljoonia käyttäjiä, mutta verrattain vähän niitä ravintolan ylläpitäjiä, ja niitä miljoonia käyttäjiä ei ole mitään syytä nyt sekoittaa sitten niihin ravintolan käyttäjiin tai millä lailla heille edes tarjota sitä, että hei, voit klikata myös tästä ja voit tehdä tässä virhe, jos klikkaat tästä. Niin mä tekisin sillä tavalla, että ne olisi täysin erillisiä sovelluksia. Mutta jos teillä on tehty se samaan React-sovellukseen se tavallinen kuluttajakäyttäjä ja sitten se ravintola ylläpitäjä, niin sitten teidän täytyy jollakin muulla keinolla erotella sieltä. Ja siihen sitten yksi keino on taas se, että siellä payloadissa, tokenin payloadissa on tieto siitä, että tämä käyttäjä nyt on sitten se manageri. Eli se pitäisi tänne sitten tänne payloadiin lisätä, että se tieto, että tämä on kuluttajakäyttäjä ja tämä on taas managerikäyttäjä. Ja silloin te voitte siellä React-sovelluksessa tarkistaa sitten, että no niin, nyt tähän näkymään on oikeus ainoastaan tällä managerikäyttäjällä, mutta ei sillä kuluttajakäyttäjällä. Ja sehän on taas sitten käytännössä tämmöinen ehdollista renderöintiä if-logiikalla, että olisi vaan uusi lisäehto siihen, että onko tuo JWT päällä tai tallessa, ja sitten onko siinä kyseessä nyt se manageri vai tavallinen käyttäjä. Mutta mä tekin sen ehdottomasti sillä, että ne olisi eri sovellukset eri osoitteessa.
Eli tavallaan hostattaisiko ne sitten Heroku puoleltakin ihan eri tavallaan osoitteessa?
Joo, jos käyttää Herokua, niin se olisi kaksi eri sovellusta, eli kaksi eri Heroku-sovellusta silloin. Eli joo, olisi eri sovelluksissa.
Ja sama back-endi tavallaan kuitenkin niillä molemmilla.
Niin, kyllä. Niin.
Okei, okay. No pitääpä tuohon tutustua.
Silloin se helpottaa sitä klientin koodausta siinä mielessä, että
niin.
Ei tarvitse välittää sitä, että siellä on niin kaksi eri käyttötasoa sille käyttäjälle.
Joo. Jees, kiitoksia.
Joo. Onko muita kysymyksiä? Any other questions? So the last question was that how to separate the manager user and the consumer user in the React side. And my answer was that what I would do is that I would separate the applications totally. The administrator or the manager user would use a totally different address to log in to his own application, and then the consumer users would have their own application. So here is the demonstration that if you check out, for example, Vault or Foodora, if you go to these pages, this login that is offered here, this is for the consumer user. This is not for the manager user. They most likely they have some different alias here, something like admin foodora.fi or something, or some other domain totally for dealing with the restaurant managers. And this is only for the consumer application. So I would use the same approach in your exercise, but if you want to have both of them in the same application, in the same React application, then the user access information, the privilege information would need to be stored in the JSON Web Token payload. That is this user an admin or not? And if it is an admin, then in React application, for example, with conditional rendering similar to this, you could then render the restaurant admin routes visible also. If the user is an admin, if it's not, then restaurant admin routes would not be visible at all. So it is a similar conditional rendering to this one. It just needs another check if you do it that way. Both ways will work technically, but logically, I would separate the applications. They still would have the same backend, just the client application is different. So that was a summary to our English speaking audience. Okay, if no other questions, then thank you for your interest. I hope you have learned something. And I will put this recording to our Moodle site. If you have any questions later on, feel free to contact me. Okay, thank you and bye.